And this is kind of cover fairly, I suppose, broad areas, and we've got three sort of speakers with different perspectives, but we were trying to think about what would sort of be appropriate for this panel, and clearly with the intergenerational report that came out earlier this year, it's obviously trying to look to the future. As the current treasurer said, supposedly people would fall off their chairs when they looked at it, and I'll show you perhaps the statistics he thought that people would perhaps fall off their chairs. And so perhaps the idea is to, I'll initially give you a very brief overview of the IGR, but that will kind of lead into thinking about the future. And of course, the IGR kind of made its projections based on what was happening in the past. So obviously one might look at the past, but also the question is, how much is the future going to mirror the past? And I'll start off with a nice quote. Actually, Benjamin Franklin, in addition to being signing the Declaration of Independence, he also was one of the sort of architects or created an early life table for the United States, and he had this wonderful quote which about nothing being certain in life but death and taxes. So I'll just give a very brief overview for the IGR. That clearly what it's projecting, and I think there were some substantial differences in the way the IGR made its assumptions about life expectancy projections, moving from sort of basically in the most recent version, it's assuming that the quite significant, and I'll show you them in a minute or two, but the quite significant secular trends that have been going on in reductions of mortality will continue for the next 40 years, and that does lead to things, to life expectancy increasing, but also there's perhaps been evidence in the past of healthier life expectancy, although the argument against, I mean, if that, that the future is, which I think Paul will be covering, is obviously there's a rise in body mass and rates of obesity, and one might, if one was a pessimist, say that this is about as good as it's going to get, and things may start to life expectancy may start to plateau, or even the next generation might have lower life expectancy, or potentially lower levels of healthier life expectancy. Real health expenditure is projected to increase from about $2,800 per person to about $6,500. I think interestingly, and I think there's now a reasonable consensus across the world that if you look at the key drivers of expenditure, you're effectively, they're normally not ageing per se, which I think they estimate is around 20%, but it's more sort of rising income, which leads to greater demand for healthcare, and also technological change, although technological change may increasingly be related to ageing, and perhaps a very good example of that is some of the high-cost cancer drugs that Australia is now just trying to grapple with. Clearly, it's now becoming more and more profitable to target diseases of the old, and that may have the interaction of those two things may have mean that ageing has much more significant effects. And ageing as a proportion of GDP will rise, it's going to be a slow creep, and I suppose there's always going to be the questions about what sort of policy choices we make within that framework. So very briefly, these are graphs straight out of the intergenerational report. It's basically assuming continuously declining mortality rates, which we've observed over the last few decades. Recent increase in life expectancy, one has got to probably attribute, hopefully we're getting bang for our buck out of current health expenditure. And perhaps I'll point out that obviously this is for the average Australian overall. There are particular groups, such as Indigenous Australians, that live significantly less. If you keep on projecting the current rates of mortality declines, which is what they do, you end up with somebody born today or in March when the report came out, living to the average male life expectancy would be over 90. And for females, heading towards 94. Now, those are clearly, very different to what we would have today in terms of people living in their mid 80s. But I suppose, as always, the question is whether they will those trends will continue. Looking back to the past, kind of an interesting graph changes in life expectancy across the 20th century using data from the Australian Bureau of Statistics, where they get life tables back to the early part of the 20th or late part of the 19th century. As you can see, the 20th century was really in two halves. The first half, the big gains were under the age of 65 years, and if you can see here, your gains per decade were effectively 4 or 5 years. Over the age of 65, there were actually relatively smooth small gains. So in the middle part, although in the 1960s, there was a debate whether we've reached our natural limits, and you would be inclined to think that at that point in time. But what came over the last four decades has been basically an increase of a year, a decade for people over the age of 65, which obviously creates large changes, and clearly it's a nightmare for actuaries writing any sort of insurance or annuity policies, and those are the sort of secular trends are quite sort of systemic risk that's hard to in the current environment to pass on or. And so I think perhaps some work I did a few years ago with Andrew Lee was to basically try and make a case of saying, well, that's of course the average. How does it differ by across socioeconomic groups? And I'm not suggesting any causality story here, but out of HILDA, you can actually, survey, you can actually very accurately predict even on a small sample Australia's overall life expectancy, and then you can use the differences in mortality rates across here a couple of groups, education groups and income groups, to predict life expectancy gaps, and they're kind of large. I mean, so someone in the lowest income quintile can expect to live 5 or 6 years less than someone in the highest income quintile, which again, I think if you're uni super, it may be a reason why they're having troubles with their defined benefit scheme, that they're not taking into account that the average academic's going to live probably a bit longer than the average, given the sort of income groups and education levels. But it's kind of an interesting, I think that's something that we need to take into account, that it is quite, life expectancy is quite reasonably heterogeneous, and I suppose if you compare it to Indigenous gaps in life expectancy, you're talking about for quintiles about half of what you get the gap in Indigenous life expectancy. If you go to deciles, you're talking about the bottom decile in Australia would have a gap that's not different to most Indigenous population. Just something that I perhaps have some preliminary work, but if you want to try and look at the future, one might try and focus on rich people. I've always wanted to create a centre for the study of the rich and famous, partly because you can write to people like Gina Reinhardt and say, could you fund this centre and we'll look at your health problems type thing? But partly because if you're looking at, I think, rich people, it gives you an idea of trends into the future, because I presume if we're going to look, if mortality is going to start levelling out, it's going to start levelling out in the rich more than the poor, I would say, first. So what I've done is looked at life expectancy of politicians based on data obtained from all Australian parliaments, and you get some interesting patterns. I wouldn't say there's too much here, but clearly what is interesting in the general population is you've got that very long flat period life expectancy at 45, didn't increase, whereas it did sort of for politicians, and probably we'd like an extra point of data here, but there's some evidence of a closing in the gap recently, which is kind of interesting, and but not really an evidence that politicians are levelling off too much, although it would be nice to have that extra data point out here. But I think that is sort of something where, again, reinforcing differences across groups. So just very briefly for obviously in Australia we have a split system between the health systems funded between state and federal governments. The federal government's responsible for Medicare pharmaceuticals. They're also the major contributor to private hospitals, although the state governments run them, but they basically provide funding agreements, and they provide the private health insurance rebate. As I said before, most of the expenditure or drivers of expenditure, people pin on things like technological change more so than the demographic factors, which the IGR estimates about 20%. So here's some projections on demographic factors, as you can see, rising over time versus non-demographic factors. So I'll very quickly, as you can see, the various breakdowns. I think what is a key in the IGR, which is leading to a lot of argy-bargy between the state and Commonwealth government, but the current government believes that they're basically going to hold public hospital expenditure constant for the next 40 years, effectively, after the rises in 2017, which I think, I suppose, is unrealistic. Something's going to have to give there. But you have got this sort of doubling in real health expenditure. Can we do better? And I'll very briefly, I suppose we can try and think about potentially looking across groups. I think trying to look at the effects of potentially chronic disease. Of course, the real question, which the other speakers will perhaps focus on, is some of the current policies or designing policies take into account this heterogeneity. And perhaps having some discussions more broadly, perhaps if there is differences in life expectancy, about whether we, to the degree to which we can close gaps. Controlling health expenditure is not necessary. I think there's no right or easy answer here. There's a range of different things I think economists could contribute. Health technology assessment, which effectively is trying to decide new technologies, whether they're cost effective or not. Disinvesting, which I think what is quite an encouraging sign, the current government has started to do that with Medicare to try and think about taking things off that are ineffective. Having some incentives to opt for cheaper treatments, these are not that apparent in the Australian system. Some sort of explicit rationing, again, hasn't really happened, and perhaps there hasn't really been, which would force explicit rationing, is caps on programs, which if you look at other countries, they've gone down that road, and there are merits and costs to that. Just to give you a couple of very quick examples of real examples of perhaps differences between Australia, in this case, and New Zealand. Here's the use of different types of diabetes drugs. And as you can see, these are various classes. These are relatively old drugs that metformin, I think, was first used in diabetes in the 1950s. The sulfonylureas are from the 70s. Both are extremely cheap. As you can see, the overall expenditure on them rose initially up until about 2004 and has been declining. These are newer oral agents. So there has been a really rapid switch by doctors towards the newest oral agents, which don't have that much solid evidence. There is some evidence that they're better in some regards, but there's not sort of an overwhelming case. But interestingly, the differences in prices here, so the older drugs are $10 and $15, the newer drugs are $60 a script. Now, Australia collectively, if you take the area under that curve, has spent about $500 million on those newer drugs. And if you look at New Zealand, they've spent nothing. So it's kind of, again, an example of very stark differences between countries in the choices they make. Are New Zealand patients being denied really effective medications? It's a bit hard to tell in terms of whether that's that case, but there is really, you know, stark differences in the way the countries are allocating resources. So perhaps perhaps my only other graph, which I'll leave, which is not directly related, but perhaps one of the questions, I suppose, in sort of modern policy is that, you know, development is this idea that one might use sort of randomised trials and randomised policy trials. What I've done is taken perhaps a leaf out of Andrew Lee's book is to actually do a search for the couple of words. Clearly, in the case of politicians, they have a belief in random sampling, they believe in opinion polls, and that if you go to Hansard, which is every word spoken in the House of Representatives, this is the use of the word opinion polls, but dates back to the 1940s. Interestingly, it peaks in the 1980s, but if you look at the word, if you actually search for the word randomised, you get one use, not surprisingly by Andrew Lee, in the 115 years of the Australian Parliament. But if you broaden it to randomised, you do get a kind of spike that actually is only in the last few years, and I haven't done a detailed search of the causal effects of whether it was endogenous or exogenous change of Andrew arriving in the Parliament, but it does give one hope that there is a move towards a sort of a use of randomisation and randomised policy trials or an acceptance by politicians. Certainly at the moment, it's outweighing opinion polls a bit in terms of its use in the Australian Parliament. Anyway, with that point, I'll pass you over to Lynne. So, our first presenter. So, basically, if we can leave the restrictions to, or the questions to, kind of questions of clarification and pretty straightforward questions, there'll be some time at the end for a general discussion and debate.
Thanks, Philip, and thanks, everybody. I'm Lynne Pezzullo. I come from the Deloitte Access Economics, Health Economics and Social Policy team. It's good to see some of the other team members here. And I'm going to talk a little bit about, or unpacking some of what Philip's been talking about in terms of how the health system is funded and what some of the trends are in the different funding mechanisms, and then looking again at the policy implications. So first of all, I guess my first point is that the health system is pretty complex. It's one of the more complex systems. But it works fairly well, and it's got lots of different moving parts, as you can see from that fabulous diagram from the Australian Institute for Health and Welfare. The major parts and the major funders, of course, major payers, are the Australian government, the state and territory governments, individuals through out-of-pocket expenses and contributions and co-payments, and also private health insurers and others who are finances, such as workers' compensation schemes in the insurance sector. apart from the different payers, there are lots of different types of payments and programs within the system. So you'll be familiar with MBS and the PBS and, of course, the hospital system, which needs to be funded. There's lots of different types of allied health, optometry, dental care and so forth that need to be funded, as well as medical care, both general practitioners and specialists. And the ways that the payments and the payers interact across those different services is quite complex. And then there are other complexities, which is that private health insurers, you know, are partly funded by federal government, and the premiums are subsidised by federal government. So there's the 30% in most cases rebate there is co-funded by the federal government as well as by individuals, and goes through the private health insurance system. But I wouldn't want to try to explain the entire workings of the health system in a 15-minute presentation. I'm just going to say that it works pretty well, our blended system of public and private. And if you look at other countries in the OECD, we often compare ourselves to the UK and the United States, because the UK, of course, has a largely publicly financed system, and the US has a largely privately financed system. And this this chart is an interesting one. We've actually got health-adjusted life expectancy at birth, which is why it's only just above 70 for Australians, because, as you've just seen from Philip's slides, it's more in the mid-80s in terms of our life expectancy. But this is health-adjusted, so we take out the disability-adjusted life years where we're actually sick, and look at that compared to what we're spending in terms of dollars per person in US dollars. And we do spend a little more than the average in terms of a percentage of GDP, slightly higher than the average, but we do get bang for our buck, because you can see that our life expectancy is pretty high. If you want to look at countries that perform better, I've stuck Japan in there, so you can see where Japan lies, often influenced by its life expectancy for females, obviously, their fantastic diet and other factors. Australians do face higher out-of-pocket costs, though. I'm not saying that is a pejorative thing. It's just an observation. Perhaps it's a good thing, actually, because it provides some marginal price signals to consumers and helps to provide the efficiency in the system which enables us to perform so well. And I've got some data here from the AIHW's Health Expenditure Australia. If you want to consult the source of all things about health expenditure, go to that fantastic publication. Comes out on about September the 30th every year, although last year it was late and it was in October, so expecting the new one out this year in a few months' time. Unfortunately, that means we've only got 2012-13 final data, but we did spend about $147 billion in that year, which was about 10% or 9.7% of GDP. In fact, the expenditure was higher than, or heading up towards 10% a few years ago, which is when they decided to take residential aged care out of the classification of health expenditure to keep it below 10%, so it looked a bit better. And in terms of the government expenditure, that's about $100 billion of that $147 billion, so pretty close to two-thirds. It has, though, been falling. The federal government expenditure has experienced a 2.4% real fall in the last year. Although there's been a 1.4% real increase for the state governments, and New South Wales drove a lot of that expenditure last year. And the growth in the state funding has been double the growth in the federal government. And I'm going to talk a bit more about those complexities and what they mean later. And the non-government expenditure, about $50 billion, and that's had an increasing share. And that's the point I want to dwell on, the fact that we are increasingly funding our own healthcare out of pocket. In fact, it's risen from 11% of the total to 17% of the total recently. There's also a little pie chart there about the hospital expenditure being 40% and medical services 18%, pharmaceuticals, which are both the scripted medicines and over-the-counter medicines, about 14%, and I'm sure you can read the rest of the chart yourself. An interesting final point, though, is the fall in real terms in expenditure per person, which is the first time in my lifetime that I've seen that happen. So it'll be interesting to see if it happens again. What is the funding breakdown by type of service? This is an interesting little chart that shows the hospital expenditure, obviously dominated by the states and territories, the primary healthcare expenditure dominated by the Australian government, but also by individuals increasingly, and the other recurrent expenditure, where we've got the Australian government and individuals again as the primary funders, and capital expenditure with state and territory governments and other non-government sources, largely not-for-profit and private hospital owners. And again, roughly the sources. The spending trending over time has been quite strong, as again Philip reflected on, 5.1% per annum over the past decade, and rising as a percentage of GDP, but only 1.5% real growth in 2011-12, which was a bit anomalous. And if we look at the state and federal government funding of hospitals, we can see how that's changed since the 1970s when Medibank and then Medicare were introduced and the Australian Hospital, Australian Healthcare Agreements were introduced. And most recently what we see is the waning interest of the Commonwealth government in funding hospitals and this big debate which we see in the Federation White Paper coming out shortly, where the Commonwealth government is really thinking more about whether it needs to divest its responsibility for hospitals to the state governments and to the next tier, the regional tier of health administration, which of course is the LHDs, the local hospital districts and the primary healthcare network, sometimes they're called by other names. Looking again to the projections and the continuation of the trends that we saw in the last chart, look at the flat projection for federal government in the intergenerational report compared to the strong growth in state and local, strong growth in individuals and other sources of funding going forward. And I want to make a particular point about why that has been embedded into the intergenerational report and leave it to you to decide whether you believe that projection, because of course that's based on the proposed policy for the first time ever. So previous intergenerational reports were full of doom and gloom. The first one basically said that we were going to go bankrupt and be a banana republic within about 10 years. And that was all due to health and aged care funding and that something desperately needed to be done. And so they did the PBS reforms and in fact what happened was less bad than what had been predicted in the first intergenerational report. So this current intergenerational report has actually said, well, we don't quite know what future policy reforms there are going to be, but we don't want to predict doom and gloom, so we're going to assume that past policy reform continues on into the future. And that's why we're going to project and put all the future policy as though the previous reform continues. It's quite a brave thing to do, really. It's saying that, well, the future is going to deliver a whole lot of efficiency and reform as it did previously without telling us what that reform might look like. So what could the government do? What are the options available? First of all, increase taxes. I'm going to dispense with that one fairly quickly with a coalition government, although of course there is a whole tax white paper coming out too and the debate about GST, which increased to 12.5% from 10% and what else we can do to the tax system. I do love the Estonian tax system. I have to put a plug in for the Baltic states in both their tax systems and their health systems compared to our very complex chart that was my first diagram. The the Estonian government, for example, has an extremely simple health system and an extremely simple tax policy. I think it's written on about 2 pages compared to the 2,000 pages of our tax legislation. And the reason for that is that it was a big white canvas in 1989 when it became a nation, but we have this inherited system of complexity which we have to deal with, and a lot of it is like putting patchwork on top of patchwork and trying to develop first best economic policy in the face of a whole lot of second best previous solutions. The second option that the government can do is to ration services, or in the federal government's case, to push more and more services to the states and territories, and we can certainly see that happening. And the third option is to push more of the burden of financing of health system onto the private sector. Philip did mention that we're going to experience continuing growth as a percentage of GDP across the health system due to technology and income elasticity of demand for health services. They've got one of the highest income elasticities of demand of any good or service, and that's because of our insatiable appetite for life and health. And it's hardly surprising because healthy life is essential to both production and consumption. So moving more into the private sector, we can do that through mandatory co-payments, which we've seen fail in the Senate recently, the increased out-of-pocket payments that might be brought in through other means, mandatory co-payments, private health insurance means testing, reducing the subsidy on PHI, threshold creep, all these ways are ways that we can push more onto the private sector. And certainly doing more in terms of outsourced services that have different funding arrangements that aren't funded by the federal government. There are great examples I see of this happening all the time. I see hospitals who reduce their diagnostic imaging budgets and expenditure by having a private diagnostic imaging service provider co-located right next to their hospital, and then they have a covered veranda where they wheel their patients to have their imaging done in that private facility where they can bill Medicare, and then they wheel them back again. That way the hospital doesn't have to provide for the funding of that particular service. And we see public-private partnerships occurring. I actually think they're very positive in how they're proliferating in all sorts of different guises. And we see funding model changes in terms of fee-for-services, sometimes replacing capitation payments or the other way around, and having outcome measures and outcome-based funding in many cases as well. And then there are the very long, brave solutions that we might find, like health savings accounts, which could completely change the structure of our financing. I'm a firm believer in health savings accounts. I think that, you know, we had health insurance in the days where didn't really know, you know, what was going to happen to us, or what we were going to die, or how long we were going to live, and there was a lot more uncertainty in the system. Now most of our health expenditure is quite predictable and will occur towards the end of our lives. So the correct provisioning, the correct vehicle for that sort of expenditure is a provisioning vehicle, not an insurance vehicle. Countries like Singapore have the right idea in having three vehicles: a provisioning vehicle, an insurance vehicle for the adverse events that might occur, based on actuarial probabilities, and they also have a safety net in the form of protection for those least able to afford to finance, either through insurance premiums or through savings vehicles. So just to finish off, I'm going to look at what the issues are to making those changes and what might occur. And this slide is really about all the politics that's currently going on. So I'm from Canberra. I've been in Canberra for 27 years and looked at, you know, how government's done health policy there for some time. Large systemic changes are very rare. I remember speaking at an osteoporosis conference in 2001 when there was an election happening, and the Minister for Health at the time basically said, in no uncertain terms, you know, you guys are looking 20 years into the future, first fracture clinics and how to prevent fractures in elderly women who are osteoporotic. Our time horizon is 5 weeks, you know, that's it. There's no further viewpoint of politics. And so to make those large systemic changes is quite difficult, but there is bipartisan recognition that we need to make changes. One of the changes is the terminology, and universal entitlement is a buzzword that came into being in the 1970s and 1980s, which sort of came to mean that everybody should be entitled to free healthcare anywhere, and it was not really meant to imply that at all. And the Federation debate is interesting because there are a whole lot of changes that could occur in terms of correcting those funding, those cost shifting issues that I mentioned before. In terms of infrastructure investment, we've got lots of things that we can invest in that are highly cost effective, which is something that Luke's going to talk about in a minute. Digitisation, e-health, and then we've got the fact that baby boomers are in retirement and over half of the voters are now over 50, which has also got political implications in terms of health reform. And the final slide, which I think you get at the end of the conference, is about the implications, what could happen, the need to adapt to new funding models where we've got higher co-payments, where removal of subsidies have occurred, where various sorts of services are means tested, where we've got capitated payments for those who are most disadvantaged, and where we've removed community rating from private health insurance, for example. Consumers are going to increasingly demand choice and control, as they do in the disability services sector and aged care community services sector. And, you know, last week we saw the launch of Telstra's Dialer Doctor, where basically people can just pay $75.90, not get an MBS rebate at all, but they get access to the treatment and the scripts that they want. I've made the point about IT and e-health increasingly playing a role in the future. Payers increasingly demanded evidence base for the funding and for the and value for money. The visit model disappearing from the health system. And finally, Australia acting more to export more health services through things like medical tourism and rural and telehealth solutions into Asia. So if we're looking into the future, those are my predictions. I'll hand back over to Philip and then...
Thank you very much, Lynne. So just questions, anything, some clarification, or any brief questions, like even any slightly longer questions should be fine.
Yes. Are there any other services like the Dialer Doctor already operating? $75.90 seems quite
think you're quite right. I think it's certainly something where there's a future growth trajectory, which is why I've stuck it on there. And it's a very sensible way to go. I mean, my GP charges $75 a consult to go and see them, and I've got to wait and book an appointment and all that sort of thing. It's very inconvenient. So I can actually dial a doctor from my car phone as I'm driving home, get a script and fill it at the pharmacy on the way home, much more convenient.
So that's obviously not for any sort of examination or not for this sort of internet.
You can send images.
Right.
If you've got a skin condition and you want it diagnosed, example, yes.
What about more aggressive positioning by Medibank and the insurer? I think that's, we see more of that in the US, don't we? That they actually are forcing much more rational behaviour by doctors and insured people.
Yeah, I'm not sure I'd describe it as aggressive, but I know exactly what you mean, and again, I support it. There's a great example of Kaiser Permanente in the United States investing in preventive health strategies for its customers, and they've been extremely effective. So it will actually reduce premiums for customers who go to the gym regularly, who lose weight, who quit smoking, who reduce their alcohol consumption. There's all sorts of incentives that they provide in terms of encouraging better preventive health and better health behaviours generally. And those have been shown through evaluations to be quite cost effective, which is obviously why they keep doing it. And similarly, Discovery Healthcare in South Africa runs similar sorts of incentivised insurance benefit. We can't do it in Australia, unfortunately, because we have this community rating issue, which is why I've got there. I suspect that'll be what might happen here, is that we do have to eventually remove a lot of the community rating we've currently got. People who don't know, community rating basically means that private health insurers cannot discriminate between customers and have them pay different premiums because of things like their BMI, their body mass index, or the amount of exercise they do, or whether they drink excessively.
Any other final questions? Or
yes, what do you see as the sort of the competitive advantage for Australia
So we're never going to be the biggest medical tourism provider in the world. We're just not. We've got countries like, you know, India and Malaysia and Singapore on our doorstep, and they're going to always be far more competitive in terms of, you know, Malaysia has dentists that can can practice at $25 an hour for their very skilled professionals, and our equivalently skilled professionals is $250 an hour. So, you know, there's going to always be that wage differential, and we're going to have people going to Malaysia to have their teeth done and lie on a beach while they recover, rather than the other way around. But we do have particular niches where we're extremely competitive, and those are in areas like IVF, particular parts of cardiovascular, plastics. And if we can develop good niches in those areas, then there's certainly opportunity. And we've certainly got potential to export a lot of that, the knowledge that we have about rural and remote medicine, into places like China in the future.
Great, thanks very much. And I should have mentioned, Lynne, your principal economist at Deloitte. I should have when I introduced you anyway.
No worries.
Thank you very much. So our next speaker is Luke Connelly, who's a professor at the University of Queensland, and he's going to perhaps focus looking at the sort of, I suppose, demand side and technological diffusion and health. And again, the same sort of rules, give a brief presentation, a few questions, and then we'll perhaps have a general discussion.
Thanks. Yeah, so I'm going to pick up on a couple of things that both Philip and Lynne have already mentioned, but focus mostly on health expenditure growth and health technology as a primary driver of that growth. So when we hear about the health expenditure and ageing and so on, often the emphasis is on the ageing population and the sort of expenditure tsunami that's predicted as a result of ageing of the population. In reality, there are several causes of health expenditure growth, and the major one is actually health technology change, health technological change in the health sector. So there is also, in this market, obviously there's widespread insurance, both public and private insurance, that reduces out-of-pocket costs, and so we have the classical problem of moral hazard as well, whether that's a problem. How strong that problem is depends on the level of co-payments that we charge for medical services, and some of those co-payments in Australia are extremely low for some classes of medical services and optometry and so on. So, and income, as I think Lynne was saying, health expenditures tend to have an elasticity of demand greater than one, so they tend to grow at a rate faster than income, and so for that reason, you know, economists would avoid saying in a public health forum that health care and health expenditures are on luxuries, but that's, of course, as economists, how we would categorise an elasticity, income elasticity greater than one. So there are obviously important contributions of medical technology to life expectancy. There's a debate amongst clinicians and epidemiologists about how great that contribution has been and whether in fact it's actually more what we do for ourselves than what clinicians do for us that's responsible for our increased longevity and longer, healthier lives. The question is though, of course, whether or not the advances at the margin, as economists, we're interested in what's the marginal contribution of the next medical technology we list, what's the health bang for the buck we're going to get from that. And in health economics, we typically try to measure these benefits not with a monetized metric, as you would in cost-benefit analysis in many other fields, but typically using a measure that combines mortality and morbidity effects. So this measure is essentially designed to try to allow us to compare different interventions that affect both the quantity and quality of life. And so the quality-adjusted life year is the technique the measure that we tend to use in cost-effectiveness analyses of new technology. So one quality adjusted life year is basically equal to 1 year in perfect health or the best possible health. Zero is death. There are, on the quality scale, you can actually have negative states as well, which are states that some people regard as worse than death. So what I want to talk about here is just a little bit about, well, you know, these new technologies that we're listing and we're subsidising with government subsidies that are sometimes consumed at zero price to the consumer. You know, what do they look like? What the committees in Australia, we've had, we've got a long-standing tradition now, since 1993 at least, for pharmaceuticals that are proposed for listing on the pharmaceutical benefits schedule must be accompanied by an economic evaluation, and this is the measure, the output measure that's typically used. So qualities are used to estimate the benefits of new and now existing technologies as well that are being reviewed on both the pharmaceutical benefits scheme schedule and the Medicare schedule. And what these measures do, as I said, is combine morbidity and mortality measures. So for instance, an intervention that improves the quality of life for a person from 0.60 to 0.80 for 5 years would give rise to one quality. So, okay, so that would be an example where you're looking only at an improvement in quality of life, no change in longevity, but the person's quality of life rises from 0.6 to 0.8 on this scale as a result of some intervention, and that would be considered equal to one life year. So when we do a cost effectiveness analysis on these new technologies, we essentially try to compare the cost, the change in costs to the changes in qualities, and say, okay, then, well, what does this intervention cost per quality adjusted life year? And the advantage of using the quality as the outcome measure is that then, in theory at least, allows you to compare across different interventions, all of which might be for quite different conditions, but either extend life or improve quality of life or both. So there's a controversy around, well, you know, so now that we're not working in a monetized metric for the benefits, how do we compare the costs to the benefits? And then this leads to the whole debate about, well, what are we willing to pay for a quality adjusted life year? I'll leave that for another day. But essentially, you know, there are rules of thumb that are used, and they're controversial to economists who know how these things are derived, where people will say, well, you know, cost per quality of $50,000 is pretty good. Cost per quality of $75,000 or more is not acceptable, and so on. So some of these committees use, by convention rather than rule, will say, well, the cost per quality threshold typically for most drugs, leaving aside rule of rescue types of considerations for rare diseases, usually you'd look at a cost per quality threshold of around $50,000. So how do these new technologies perform in terms of the number of qualities they produce? There's a review published last year in a journal called Pharmacoeconomics that reviewed all of the cost utility analyses. So with this quality measure, we talk about cost utility analysis, just a form of cost effectiveness analysis. All cost utility analyses that were published in 2010 in all journals, they found 370 studies, and the mean quality gain was 0.06. So that translates to about 3 weeks of perfect health. So the median gain was about 3 weeks of full health, which is pretty small. So if a submission were received from a pharmaceutical manufacturer by the Pharmaceutical Benefits Advisory Committee that had this size gain and the cost of the treatment was $3,000, it's highly likely that would then pass the quality test. And of course, this is what the manufacturers can do. They can say, we know how many qualities this produces, and we have some evidence from trials. And what we're going to do is use what we think is the threshold these guys are using to decide on a listing or not, and we derive the maximum price from that. So it's quite straightforward to do that. So, you know, this prompts one when you see these types of submissions coming through these committees, and several, Philip and I have both been on committees of this kind. As you see these submissions come through with these very small quality gains, it forces you to start thinking, well, you know, first of all, there are problems with the quality measures. They're stated based on stated preference data, and while we still use these sorts of data in, you know, across the board in health economics, we now know that you know, other stated preference methods such as contingent valuation are so hopeless we don't use them anymore. So we're still using stated preference data to get these measures, and then you think, okay, well, what's the measurement error associated with that, and what's the real gain that's happening to the health status of the person, the underlying health capital, health stock? And this raises the possibility that, notwithstanding the great contributions that some medical technologies have made, and particularly in areas such as cardiac, coronary heart disease and some other things, that some of these technologies are marginal. So the next type of scan that comes out, you know, may have all sorts of greater physical properties than the existing scanner, but the question is, does it change the diagnosis? Does it change the health outcome? And often the answer is maybe not, or that the evidence that it does is not so great. So we then have to ask, well, what's the marginal product of the intervention, and what are we willing to pay for that marginal product? There's also some important issues about the types of processes we use in Australia to do this. So one of the advantages of the systems that we have here is that we do actually end up with lower prices for some drugs if you take them on average. And there are some examples that Philip's pointed out where we pay more than some other countries, and we list drugs that some other countries, such as New Zealand, don't. So a number of other countries have a similar type of system to us now, and basically these particular committees consider safety, effectiveness and cost effectiveness of new technologies or proposed listings on the schedules. And what that involves is a bit of a trade-off, because the originators or the owners of the intellectual property that's vested in these particular products also have to think about, they're obviously monopolists, many of them, if they've got the patent on the new chemical entity or whatever. And so then they have to decide as well, when do we want to launch in Australia, or will we launch in Australia at all? So the longer these processes take, the lower the price due to government monopsony power under these types of conditions, especially with pharmaceuticals in Australia, where we have a pharmaceutical benefits pricing authority as well, which will negotiate with the manufacturers, have some incentives to launch later in jurisdictions where they know the price will be lower, because you don't want to set that benchmark internationally. So you can imagine that as a third degree price discrimination discriminator, you can then segment the markets geographically. And in order to maximise profit, you'll launch sequentially in markets with successively lower prices till you get down to marginal cost in order to maximise your profits. And there's some fairly strong evidence of this. Some of it's not strong, some of it's just anecdotal, but there is some good work by Danzen and others who looked at drug launches in 25 different countries for the period 1994 to 1998. And during that period, there were 85 new chemical entities, so these are new compounds that turn up in a pharmaceutical, And they found that only 55% of the possible launches in those 25 countries actually occurred. But what's interesting about that is where they occurred. So in the US, 73 out of the 85 new chemical entities were launched. So the US, apart from perhaps the Medicare scheme in the US, which is not universal but for the elderly, and you know, perhaps some aspects of Medicaid, which is for the poor and disabled, doesn't really have centralised pricing. So you can start to see that these policies, if you then move to Australia, you get 43 out of the 85 entities being launched here, and these are just three examples, but 13, New Zealand was the worst performer, had the lowest launch rate, and that's partly because it has pays very low prices for new chemical entities and has a similar process to the one that Australia uses. The thing is, we don't actually know what the welfare effects of this are, so it's quite difficult to know whether the drug launch delays in Australia, for example, are optimal or suboptimal with respect to the benefits we get from those delayed launches. The benefits are obviously lower prices. The costs of that are perhaps foregone health benefits as a result. There's also some evidence that the mean age of drugs that are taken by Australians tends to be quite a bit older than those in the US, which will also reflect some launch delays as well as the non-launch of new technologies here of some of them. So the drug prices that we pay are around 20 to 40% lower than the US on average, and we actually consume, though, per capita about 140% of the drugs that the US population takes of these prescription drugs. And so, once again, you know, if you think about especially antibiotics and other things which can have negative externalities associated with them, the more I take of antibiotics, the more highly likely, and others do, the more highly likely is that when you need that antibiotic, the bacteria will be resistant to it. And that, of course, that negative externality in consumption, most economists would say, okay, you've got a negative externality, you should tax it. But what do? We subsidise it. So, and we pay zero prices or very close to them, depending on which category of consumer, whether you're on a concession card and so on. So is what we've got optimal? We don't really know. There are reviews of current items on the schedules that are being undertaken to say, well, we know that this thing doesn't really work, so why are we paying for it? But that's really a very, you know, maybe not even a micro level, it's a very meso level type of analysis, and I think some further analysis at a larger level is required, including some work on diffusion of these drugs and technologies geographically within Australia. Australia does need to confront the role that consumer co-payments for medical services and therapies might play, even though that's been very difficult. The thing is that with most healthcare services, and this is a sort of gross generalisation, but essentially what we know from the RAND health insurance experiment in the US is that by the time you charge a co-payment of about 20% on most services, you get rid of moral hazard. So so people on plans that who had to pay full price for their services, who were later given an income boost to offset that, would consume about the same amount as people who paid a 20% co-payment on their services. So you don't actually have to make people that much to attenuate some of the moral hazard. Things like the GP co-payment are intensely unpopular, of course, but you could do introduce these types of co-payments while using safety nets and things to preserve the equity objectives of Medicare and improve their efficiency as well. And so, you know, for example, it's interesting that the schedule fee of $35 for a level B consult, which is a standard consultation, the $7 co-payment that was originally proposed represents precisely a 20% co-payment. And the interesting thing about this is in 2011, the government actually increased the subsidy. So the way the Medicare schedule works, as many of you will know, is there's a schedule fee, which is not the market price, so the doctors can't be made to charge the schedule fee, but it's a lower bound at which point you hit. So when the doctor does actually charge you, in the old days, 85% of the schedule fee, then you're at bulk billing, so you pay nothing out of pocket. What the Rudd government actually did was increase that proportion of the schedule fee that's paid as a rebate from 85% to 100% for GPs. And the purpose of that was to try and preserve or increase bulk billing rates, which were fairly good anyway. And what we showed a few years back is that, unfortunately, what happened is that busy doctors who were already, you know, working as much as they wanted to, essentially substituted leisure for work time because they had an income windfall. And so so there was actually evidence, first I've ever seen in the real world, of a backwards bending supply curve where GP service volumes actually fell. We would like to have followed that up, but for some reason after we published that paper, the data no longer appeared on the website of the Commonwealth. So I don't know if that's cause and effect or serendipity. So we do have some very good aspects to the health system in Australia. The institutional arrangements we have do seem to lower prices for many procedures and drugs. The processes and the outcomes that they give rise to does, however, provide some disincentives for the owners of this IP to launch their products in Australia and or to delay those. So while at the moment those arrangements have helped contain expenditures, really co-payments have been put in the freezer, and I think actually, you know, the freeze on Medicare subsidies is going to be the way that the government addresses that rather than do anything explicit. So you let the schedule fee, the market price rise over time and do nothing to the schedule fee for a while, and that way you end up with co-payments on those services and have the same effect. But I think as we get more and more new technologies, there is an interplay, of course, between the ageing of the population and the use of these technologies. So the question of co-payments and safety nets and so on will have to be addressed as we move into the future with this. And there are large parts of the therapeutic industry that actually don't fall within this Medicare remit. So there are things for people with disabilities, and we know that the burden of disability in the future will also be increasing. So we want in the intergenerational report, we've got arguments that we need to increase workforce participation for older people. We know that, for example, hearing loss is a big problem in that population. You've got things like captioned telephones and other things that can help people in that situation, but they don't actually fall within this framework. So there's some other areas too that I think we need to look to in the future. Thanks, Luke.
Thank you very much, Luke. So any questions or comments or months we'll have an opportunity to revisit just at the end. Yes, yep.
I was just interested to hear your comment about the negative externalities of antibiotics, and I guess that's probably an example where before pre sort of resistance there were positive externalities of taking antibiotics, you would say, and that's kind of transitioned now with the increased uptake.
Yeah. Yeah, it probably is. It's similarly, you know, with vaccination, there are positive externalities as well, and that's partly what, in the case of measles, mumps, rubella, has actually led to declining rates of vaccination, especially in the UK with some of the autism controversy that was around for a while there, based on really dodgy evidence, by the way. So yes, you know, in that case, you know, the standard positive externality argument would say you should subsidise it, which is what we do. I think, yes, giving consumers, all consumers, a reason not to consume particular antibiotics in the form of a small co-payment that actually convinces them when they go to the doctor you don't need antibiotics is probably a good thing.
So,
a
question over here, yes.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the unit that you're measuring. Effectively, you're saying that a year of extra life to anybody, anywhere, is equivalent. Is that right? This sort of unit you're using. That was a very strange thing, really.
Yeah. Look, it is strange, and the preference-based information from random samples of the population suggests that that's not at all how people view a quality-adjusted life year. So a quality-adjusted life year for a child will be valued by a member of the public as different from a quality-adjusted life year for an adult, especially an elderly adult. But then furthermore, there's also evidence from the economic literature, not so much health economics but other parts, that the value of life to people who are nearing the end of life, people are willing to spend, you know, so the willingness to pay, this notion of the willingness to pay for a quality adjusted life here, if you get to the end of life and you can live for another 3 weeks by spending $50,000, and many people would do that, so if they had the resources to do so. So that raises but yes, basically the way the metrics applied, it does depend on that underlying assumption that a quality is a quality is a quality.
What's the better way of doing it?
I think the better ways of doing it would include trying to take account of public preferences over things like, you know, the age of the recipient. That raises a whole lot of equity issues, and it also raises some questions about when you ask the general public questions about their preferences over different disease states, and this is the way sometimes the weights are derived for these colleagues, you also have to wonder how much measurement error there is in the responses and how much of the same problems that afflict contingent valuation, which we've now thrown out, essentially, how much of those problems of stated preferences in contingent valuation also afflict these, which, and then in ways, some of the health-related questions are much more complex than asking you whether you want to spend $10,000 to save 20,000 birds or something. You know, it's actually much more difficult to understand some of the health trade-offs, I imagine, for the general public.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you, Dennis.
So our final speaker, Paul Frijters, is also from the University of Queensland. And I'll just find the right presentation here, and the ANU. So I'll hand you over to Paul, who will perhaps go to more of this sort of speculative end of things and cover a broad canvas, one might say.
Okay, thanks very much for the invitation and introduction, Phil. So I want to talk about two big ticket cost items in the health budgets for many countries, but also for Australia, and wonder whether there are ways in which we can reduce the cost of those two big ticket items, or what kind of political questions this throws up. So, for instance, the talk we've just had puts up a pristine picture of how we allocate resources. The idea is, well, if it's more than 50,000 qualities per year, we don't do it. If it's less, we do do it. But in reality, there are quite a few circumstances where we pay a lot more for a healthy life year, and we know we pay a lot more. So, for instance, there are life-threatening diseases for which we can pay 10 times more than this. Now, for an economist, this means I'm willing to shoot 10 random people to save him, because he's got the threatened disease. Let's call it the disease of Pompe. But 10 of you, I won't give enough health care so that you die. But you don't know beforehand who it is. Now, that raises a lot of political issues. He will complain if you take his life away, because take his medicine away, he dies. But 10 of you will die if you don't. How do you vote? Well, if you're rational, you'll vote for yourself. But it turns out you often vote for him. So you take, as it were, huge chances with your own death, because he's there, and you'd have to sort of almost consciously kill him off to reduce your own chance of death. Now, these kind of public allocation games are notoriously difficult. They become very quickly emotional, very strongly tied to marketing efforts and to direct pressures on ministers. And I'm going to talk about some other examples of that. Right? But within our healthcare system, hence, we'd like to think we'd want to go to a rational allocation, but this is often very difficult when you get to emotive issues. And I'm going to talk about two of those. So I'm going to talk about end-of-life health expenses. Right? This is the issue that a lot of healthcare happens just when you're about to die anyway, and we try lots of different things to keep you alive for another week, but you suffer from 10 diseases, and if one thing doesn't get you, the other thing will get you. And those are very difficult allocations. Right? There is a hopelessness about spending more money, but also an almost inevitability about spending more money. Family and friends will demand it. And then I'm going to talk about individual choices in public health costs. We've had long debates about smoking, and smokers to some degree pay for themselves for having these huge taxes on their cigarettes. And I'm going to talk about the case of obesity, which Philip Clarke already talked a little bit about, as to whether it should be extended to that, and whether it's going to be extended to that. And so this is going to feed into the sort of the discussion part. Well, who actually makes the trade-offs? And who is seen to make them? And this matters an awful lot for the way that we've structured our institutions. We often try to hide these trade-offs because they're so painful. So end-of-life health expenses, I took this from a Grattan Institute paper. Something like 90% of Australians die in hospitals or in residential care homes. So they die in, as it were, you know, the health industry. These are expensive deaths, often against the stated wishes of people who say they want to die at home. No, you're going to die with tubes in your arm. So like it or loathe it, dying is an industry, and it's a multi-billion dollar industry. This is the best data I could find on Australia from Langdon et al. They follow the veterans because the Department of Veteran Affairs pays everything for the veterans. And so we know particularly well how costly they are when they die and when the costs go up or not. So it's sort of the best data we have on this. So this is the total resource cost by month to death. And that is the moment the veteran dies. And this, hence, is the cost profile of the months beforehand. So 6 months before a veteran dies, per month, that month, it costs about $2,500. Okay. Now, $2,500 for another month. If that expenditure would save him, if he would otherwise die, from a quality point of view, makes sense, if that's the life-saving thing. But of course, the reality will often be that that expenditure won't save him at all. He's going to die anyway. This may make his life a little bit more pleasant, or it could be a hopeless thing already. So in terms of quality, that probably already is not cost-effective. It fails the test that Lou Connelly put up as to what we should fund and what we don't fund. But we already do it. It's mandatory that we do it. Now this goes up and up and up, and the particular cohort that Langdon chose to look at was the cancer cohort. So these are people diagnosed with cancer, and the idea is hence that once they're diagnosed with something that is life-threatening, you have, as it were, an instrument to start to predict, okay, how costly are they going to be? So for the cancer cohort, close to death in the last month of life, you cost something like $10,000, $11,000 in your last month of life. Now that is a huge expenditure, right? You put that up against a whole year. Well, for that year, you'd pay something like $120,000, $130,000. And that is not saving you. That is just spending on you. Right, so it's not even paying for a quality year, it's just, as it were, pure expenditure. And the question in Australia is, and there have been lots of white papers on this, or at least debates on this, is, well, isn't there a cheaper way to let people die? And this is often put in terms of, well, a dignified death versus a tube death. But for an economist, the question is just, is this bang for buck? And it's very hard to say that this is bang for buck in any rationing sense, right? From a population rationing sense, this makes no sense. Now, I had an honors student last year, Belinda McKeony, so this is her honors thesis, and she looked at the cost of death in the US, right, for which we have slightly better data. So what she looked at, and what you look at here, is a histogram of bootstrap expenditure for decedents, right? You often try to find out, well, how much did they cost in the last year of their life? It's sort of hard because you don't exactly have the 12 months beforehand. So you need to have a little model. But what came out of that model is this one. So that is where the average person in the year of his death costs something like $44,000 in the US from a variety of health sources. So this is also out-of-pocket payments. This is hospitals. This is a lot of different expenditures. Now that's $44,000 in the last year of life, which is not keeping him alive. That's just the expenditure on him. So this is not bang for buck even. But you see a huge right tail into that, right? You see people who, as it were, cost up to $100,000 in the last year of life, and some who cost $20,000. But you will note, there's almost no one in this data who has a cheap death, right? Death is expensive for almost the entire population, right? Which hence tells you that, as it were, this is an industry, right? You're almost not allowed to die cheaply. Now then, from a policy point of view, the question comes a little bit, well, are there predictably expensive deaths? Right? Is there such a death that you can see coming beforehand, oh, this person is going to die very expensively? Is there some moment at which you should, as it were, cut off the subsidy tap? So this is just a summary of adjusted healthcare expenditures per period. And you see that someone who died this year costs on average $44,500 in that year. You see that someone with a cancer diagnosis and a stroke and a heart disease diagnosis have relatively high deaths, high costs as well. So these are not dying yet in that year, just they have been diagnosed with cancer, stroke, or heart disease, and that makes them cost close to $25,000 to $30,000 per year after that diagnosis. Now, from a cost-benefit point of view, that would mean that this should, as it were, increase their chances of survival by 50%. This expenditure. Well, I can tell you it won't do that. It will only do a fraction of that. Right? So again, we are indeed here looking at groups of patients for whom the qualities are basically way above 50,000 per year. Now, we then looked, can we identify an even closer group for whom the expenses seem to make little sense? Well, what we did is we divided up this population between people who were hence diagnosed with these diseases, like cancer, heart disease, or stroke. And we looked at the people for whom, in the first year of that diagnosis, they cost more than 50,000 or less than 50,000 and still survived. So we basically divided between the people we've paid $50,000 for, presumably to keep them alive somewhat, and then see how much that buys us versus the people we didn't pay $50,000 for. Well, the people we paid $50,000 for in the first year of their diagnosis, their expected life years, because they're still alive after that 1 year, their expected life year is hence 1.26, 1.15, depending on whether you take the old ones with this diagnosis or the young ones with this diagnosis. And young is now under 75 for this population. So that tells you that if we spent $50,000 on you in the previous year and you're still alive, you're only going to survive a couple of more months, on average. So from a quality point of view, we spent $50,000 for a couple of months. Right? That is the way that you can read this in the best case scenario, if we presume that the $50,000 was needed to keep you alive. And so you see the rationing problem here, but you can also see the emotional, political problem here. Who the hell is going to pull the trigger here? Right? Who's going to decide who is worthy of health intervention and who is not? We don't have a system, an allocation system at all in this country or anywhere else where these decisions are made. So the salient aspect is that the health decisions here are not made with cost-benefit in mind. Right? The pristine picture we were just given of who do we help, who we don't, doesn't fit at the end of life. An end of life is very, very costly. This is a big part of the health system. For a hospital, a terminally ill patient is just a very valuable customer, right? They make money off this, and that is why we put them there, right? And this is hence a stakeholder problem. So we did find that yes, if you look in the data hard enough, you can find health costs for some recognized groups to be much higher than the maximum cost per quality, which could be $40,000, $50,000, right? So put otherwise, what does this mean, a health cost more than 50,000 qualities? Well, we're willing to take life years away from others in the population to help those at the end. That's what it means. It basically means others in other parts of their life are being taken away, life years, for the benefit of the others. And it's more than a one-to-one that's being taken away. Well, policy options, right? Well, what can an economist think of? We think of this less in terms of what's the existing structures, who decides now, and how do we tweak this or that? Step back a little bit more and think of this as a simple, as a contract that you have with individuals as to what health care they get through life. Right? So the open choice one would seem to be the market perfect one, right? Which is, well, let people decide themselves early on in life what the health packages they want. Do you want 20 doctors in your bed the last 2 months of your life? Or do you want much better preventative care early on? Right? That's the basic package you can offer people. So a pure choice-based thing. Where do you want, as it were, your health expenditure rights to be concentrated in life? In which areas? So you could think of that as a sort of a multiple health insurance package, right? Which is hence either heavy on end-of-life rights or very low on end-of-life rights. Right? And you can have particular triggers as to when entitlements get off the table. It could be age-related, it could be diagnosis-related. Now that's open choice. That is treating people like rational people whom you can contract with early on in life about what happens later on in life. That is treating them as an economic rational agent. So that's why I say it's first best. But if you don't presume that people can make this kind of choice, or can keep to it, you can do it by stealth. You can basically, as a benevolent policy planner, smuggle this in. You can, for instance, surreptitiously underfund those aspects of the health system that mainly cater for end of life. So you no longer do the operations that are almost all completely oriented towards those people about to die anyway. You can try and close down the facilities where the expensive deaths take place, right? And hence hope that people then go to other places where they're cheaper. So you can by stealth try to do it a little bit with this in the back of your mind. Or you can have a policy of death management. Right? Think of some way in which you organize facilities to have cheaper deaths, if you like. A die-at-home package, maybe, has been talked about. Now, problems, we're economists, we know choices are unlikely to be time consistent. Whatever you agreed to when you were 20, come your deathbed time, you're probably going to shout, I want the help anyway. And your families and friends are unlikely to keep to your earlier life choices and say, well, he made his choice when he was 20. Once you're 85, your grandchildren are going to come up with all kinds of reasons why your earlier choices, 25, shouldn't be kept to now. So that's the problem with, number one, the open choice. The stealth one, you're going to get resistance from the parts of the health industry to make money. And they will push the emotional buttons hard in the media. And that sort of makes it really difficult to talk about this for politicians. So you're probably going to have to hide the real discussions. You're probably going to have to do this behind closed doors. Now then the second problem, obesity and health costs. I did a paper a long time ago, in 2007, where we found out that, as it were, the mild obese actually didn't die earlier. They lived just as long, but they cost about $2,000 to $3,000 per year more than the non-obese ones. And the majority of this cost was in some way on a community. Needn't have been the country as a whole, but usually some large insurance pool. Now, that finding was fairly robust to inclusion of age, and it holds to today. In fact, the costs have now gone up. The $2,000 to $3,000 were in the US, now it's probably more $3,000 to $4,000. And Australia, I've tried to look for estimates of people who've looked at this, and they vary. There's probably about half of this. Right? So this is the best I could find. This is New South Wales data of people who are above 45. The data comes from Corda et al., it's just been published. And they hence look at the cost, and this on the left-hand side you see the mean costs. Right, and then you see for different hence age groups, and on the horizontal scale is BMI. 30 is the cutoff point for obesity, but you see a fairly linear relationship after about 26, 27, which is mildly overweight, in terms of health costs. Right, and you see that it rises from around 1,200 for someone who's, as it were, perfect weight, BMI 24, 25, and it rises to above 3,000. For those who are morbidly obese. And you don't see this relationship with the very old, right? Then it goes away. So you see this relationship with a particular age cohort, i.e. up to 80 years. Now what are the options again, right? This is a predictable cost of health. Now economists tend to think, I certainly think of BMI as effectively a choice, right? We treat people again as rational agents. Right? They choose how much to eat, how much to exercise. Sure, you can say that some people have more cravings than others. You can even say there's a genetic variation in these things. But as an economist, we noticed that around 1900, no one was obese, not even the rich people could afford all the food. And now, it's almost 50% of the older population is starting to be obese, and the rates are still rising. And we tend to, in economics, to see this as a choice, to see this as ultimately something that people can control, just as we think they can, or maybe even should control, their smoking. So what's the first best solution? Treat it as a choice. If it's a choice to be expensive for the community, tax that. Right? This is a direct externality. Economics 101. Treat it as a choice, and there are various ways to do that. One way is to just vary the insurance premiums, or co-payments by medicines which are BMI related. So this is breaking the community insurance that Lynne already talked about, and she anticipated that this might well happen on a variety of issues. A problem, of course, is that the high BMIs will object, and the problem is that they're starting to be the majority of the population. So from a political point of view, this may not be so easy, right? They will like the implicit subsidies that the not-so-heavy are transferring towards them. Now the second choice is, again, offer different packages with BMI-friendly and BMI-unfriendly options. Right? So that you get self-selection to some degree, so that the people who are heavy on BMI take packages which are BMI-friendly in terms of their medicines, but they give up rights in other things. So they give up rights on other forms of health services. Right? So this is almost a surreptitious version of that first best one. Or we treat it as a social outcome. We basically say, no, let's not take people as rational individuals, let's just take them as victims of some kind of system. And then, well, we want to vary the system. And we want to think about what system creates lots of BMI people. And there's an awful lot of research going into, well, what these systems are, what cultures create high BMI. The jury is out, right? I have my own theories, other people have their own pet theories, but the jury is out. We really don't know. And the problem is that our best guesses are outside of policy at the moment, and that we hence even don't know which policies to go. So the essential problems, and this is my wrap-up slide, I think, indeed, which is that the basic economics of the health costs of end-of-life and obesity are simple. From an economic point of view, this is not hard stuff, right? You don't need to, as it were, have studied a lot of economics to immediately say, okay, how should we organize this? What's this first best? If people are rational economic agents, we would solve this in a jiffy. But the problem is, hence, one of politics, one of marketing, one of coordinating social choice. It's very hard to openly discuss trade-offs in health, leading to locked-in misallocation of resources. The visible losers make noise, and the invisible losers, those who don't know that they are affected because they're perfectly healthy and they don't know that, as it were, the preventative measures haven't been taken on them, they make less noise. They don't know even that they've lost out some sort of battle for research resources. So this is the Machiavellian problem. He talks about this. You know, the uncertain winners are not going to back something because they don't even know they're winners. But the visible losers will fight it. Now, this industry is media savvy. They know how to reach the media. There's a Dr. House program where the doctors are the heroes every day. And they have a great tab on the media, and of course particular groups, particular pharmaceuticals, but any sort of interest group within health is very well organized towards reaching the media. So it's very difficult to even talk about solutions in this area. And the health system is exceedingly complex, as Lynne told already, which means that the majority of the population, including myself perhaps, don't really know how all the aspects of the health system work, which makes it easy to manipulate us. Right? Makes it easier to pull the wool over our eyes and get us to believe something which isn't quite in our best interest. So the main thing that, from an economic point of view, comes out of this is that we sort of want to take decisions on these important traders out of the political sphere as much as possible, right? Which is what you already talked about, Lynne, when you talked about having set budgets for whole areas of health and then having a more technocratic, quality-based allocation within that set of outcomes. And we could hence be talking about a fixed budget for pharmaceuticals, but we could also be talking about a fixed budget for particular health problems that we then spend in a particular way. So politicians should perhaps control the overall budget of various items, make the political choices as to who is deserving of our money and who is not, right? Set the basic principles, but then step back, right? And basically let, let a group of people with a given goal function, choose the best outcomes. So we're probably thinking about statutory authorities, which we already have in a whole variety of areas, right? Having more hands off of the politicians and having a given overall project.
All right, thanks very much, Paul. So any questions specifically, Paul, and then I'll kind of open it up.
My understanding of BMIs is good for overall populations, but you can't transfer that to individuals.
Well, this hence goes to the question whether you see it as a choice or not, as an individual choice. I mean, from an economic point of view, our natural penchant is to see it as an individual choice. But even if we think as economists that there is, as it were, a deeper social reason for it, and the deeper social reason could be food has become cheaper, or the deeper social reason could be anxiety levels are up because competitiveness in society goes up, something like that. Even if one thinks of those things as the drivers, one is still thinking of the solutions as being to optimize incentives. So the question is, what changes behavior? And well, this is the question of, do monetary incentives change behavior? Well, we generally think they do. So we basically pick the main policy instrument we have, which is monetary incentives that are aligned with these externalities to either change behavior or at least have it be neutral in terms of their distributional effect.
Other? Yes?
Yep. On the end of life expenses, have you thought about giving individuals, as a policy proposal, individuals a choice so that if they are diagnosed with cancer and there's a number of years that they might have left and there's an anticipation of how much that might cost, that they could do a deal to give some back to the government and some to their grandchildren or something along those lines?
Yes, one can think of those kind of things. One is then, of course, directly in the political realm of what are the entitlements that that person has that another person does not have, right? So as soon as you say, look, you've been diagnosed with this, now you have a pot of money which you didn't have before. You can think of the moral hazard problems of the diagnosis, but also the political fights that you're going to have with how big that pot of new money then is for them, right? But yes, you can put this in the package, right? In principle, what you're just saying is, earlier in life, you can choose a package. And that package could include, you are diagnosed with this, you give your remaining budget to your kids. And apart from that, you know, go to the top of a mountain and die. Right, that's what.
One more question, and then I'll open up for
it. This was common on that. I mean, is that nature of insurance, right? Mm-hmm. You can do that now. I can do cancer insurance right now. And
yep.
Yeah. Yep. So you can do that. You don't have to do that.
Okay. No, that's right. You can do that already.
Yeah. So any others? We've got a few minutes remaining. Anyone like to jump in?
Come on, guys.
Yes.
Anybody?
Yes, anyone to any of the speakers, or just make a general comment? Yes. Yeah.
I think sort of drawing some of the presentations together, I think the intergenerational report talks to the increase in life expectancy in about 5 years, and to achieve that, you're going to double expenditure per person,
which
is a massive investment, right? We've talked about some specific issues, but we sort of think about there's a lot of low value care that goes on at the moment, and there's a lot of focus on the adoption of new things, and whether or not those new things will deliver additional money. Process of accelerating the disinvestment from the low value care into things that actually generate value and impact, and sort of we get the same curve of life expectancy, but we sort of reduce the cost.
Oh, that's really, but I always a dollar of waste is a dollar of someone's income. That's the only comment I'll make. And Lynne, that's right.
Yes, I think you know what Luke was talking about in terms of the use of incremental cost effectiveness ratio to do analyses of what is a good investment and what isn't, and also bearing in mind the data limitations that Paul was alluding to. I think the development of league tables is quite typical across hospital systems, primary healthcare systems across the world. And so the good evidence basis for forming those league tables and then for ensuring that they occur in practice is really the best way of making sure that we're getting the lowest hanging fruit. Or at the moment, I think we've got fruit that's hanging on the that's actually sitting on the ground, because that's the preventive health space. Yeah. but then it's definitely league tables of incremental cost effectiveness ratios for different people in different situations.
Yeah, one of the things is about it, modern medicine is that, you know, every new proposal is evidence-based. There are a whole lot of things that doctors do that have really not very much good evidence attached to them. The problem is one that Paul referred to, which is that these are typically, especially among specialties, they're fairly well organised groups, are fairly vocal, and they usually got a particular subgroup of patients who are also prepared to be quite vocal about taking something off the schedule. So last year there was an example, I think it was last year, I forget what the condition was, but they were using hyperbaric chambers to treat this population of individuals with a particular condition. And at great expense, in the Medicare item was $100,000 for a course of treatment. And there was actually zero evidence of anything. So there are things like that are really no-brainers to take off the schedule. And the Commonwealth is going through some of those processes at the moment of trying to revise what's on there, what should be on there, what shouldn't be. But a similar thing really should also happen with private health insurance policies that include ancillary benefits. We talked about this earlier on. And, you know, the package, the inclusions that are available in a given menu, and you can choose two of these areas, will include some areas of so-called therapies that are really not evidence-based at all, and really, if you're paying insurance premiums in a community-rated sense, to carve out those, you know, allow selection. One of the problems, I think, in Australia at the moment is that the community rating regulations are actually so strong that the minister has the right of veto over a particular policy. So a new policy that was proposed that excluded cancer, for example, the minister would say, no, we can't exclude treatments for cancer. So the community rating fabric is much more than just a common premium for the people who take it. It actually includes some policies on what you're allowed to exclude.
Okay, just any other final or comments? So we've got a couple of minutes. Yes?
Thank you.
Yeah, one of the things that we looked at first when we were when advising hospitals on how to reduce their costs was to look at the catchment area of aged care facilities. And there's the great example of the Austin and more recently in Queensland, the Ipswich Hospital, which developed outreach programs to those aged care facilities. And I went around, I think 90% of the residents took up the offer to do an advanced care directive, refusing to be transported to hospital and have expensive end-of-life treatment, saved the Austin $35 million in its first year. And that said, you know, there is a lot of evidence of people who do want to receive treatment for things like, and I know a lot of those examples of cancer were quite expensive, but a lot of that is pain relief and making people extremely comfortable. So you go from a QALY score or a DALY score of 0.9, you know, to 0.05, which is a huge improvement in quality of life by people, keeping people comfortable, even though it's not going to prolong their life. I mean, you don't want them to die slowly in agony, so it probably does pass the eye for test.
Did it save or cost the Austin at the end of the day? If they wise, why did it save them money if they're treating these people under our system, surely, as, which is what Paul was making.
Yes, yeah. That $35 billion is less revenue for them.
Yes.
Why would they want that to some degree, unless they care, right? From an industry perspective, we economists don't expect them to go for this.
Yeah.
But I think in a public hospital, like, you tend to find that, and when you speak to doctors, particularly in sort of general medical boards, you talk about end-of-life care, they can get into the business of medicine, particularly in a public sense, to be involved in managing someone's death. It's about having that bed filled with someone when you're actually going to do good. Mm-hmm. And that's where the conversation, we need to sort of move to that, you know, towards the way, because it is a constrained system. You know, the ABM model isn't really an ABM model.
But this is an important one, because whenever I talk to doctors about these things, they always tell me they don't care about money, they're there to do good as they arrive in their Ferrari and go home to their villas, right? At the end of the day, we cannot treat them like this as economists. We just have to presume they're industry providers out there to maximize their revenue. Any other type of interaction, which is, oh, you're the dark shining knight, and I cannot expect you to behave like a rational agent, it's just not a way to go. So I disagree that we should go to the conversation which presumes that they're good and the rest is not so noble. No, we should just treat them as rational service providers, and as it were, be as consumers on the other side and also be rational. The famous studies which, you know, family of doctors take up much less health services because they know it's useless, right? Which tells you something about what doctors don't care about then. Apparently, people who are not their family members.
Medical litigation hasn't helped either because, unfortunately, they feel like they're obliged to provide care because it's the expectation of the patient, even though they know it won't be effective.
Then I won't cut things just in terms of just with that flashing light. I presume we're actually on time. I'd like to thank the speakers. Perhaps I would make one plug that 100 years ago there was an early economist called Edgar Seidenstricker, and one of the points he made: if you were designing an insurance system, you want to pay doctors for keeping people out of not seeing patients.
That's right.
We've yet to achieve a century later. Anyway, I'd like to thank the speakers. I'd like to thank the audience. Anyway,